the thousands of acres of crops that grow around Uvalde, Texas, are an attractive sight to a hungry world. They're attracted to insects. That makes them attractive to bats. And that makes them irresistible to three researchers who are trying to develop a whole new approach to pest control. Uvalde is not your typical Texas town.
Uvalde sits at the intersection of the two longest highways in the United States. We'd call it a rural community, and it's an agricultural community. Our entire economy is based on agriculture. We can raise a vegetable crop almost 12 months out of the year. We have very, very mild winters, and the crops can stand the cold temperatures that we have. So at any given month, there is some vegetable crop in the ground or being harvested. $83 million ag income, historically, is what we normally run. And so agriculture is big business, and it is the main business in the region.
But the fertile fields of Uvalde face many enemies. One of the worst is this one. This is the dreaded corn earworm moth. This moth flies into cornfields in search of plants where they can deposit their eggs. It does this when the young ears are silking. The eggs hatch into hungry, destructive larvae that feed relentlessly on the succulent silk and tender kernels. The larvae are aggressive and will kill other larvae that trespass on their ear of corn. After about 2 weeks of gorging on the corn, the bloated larvae drop to the ground and burrow into the soil. This subterranean layer is where they pupate and complete their transformation into moths. After 2 weeks underground, the pupa hatches into a moth. Once free of its shell, it fights its way back to the surface. The newly emerged moth can't fly just yet. Their wings must first unfold and extend. Now, they're ready to invade the night and begin the whole cycle all over again. A natural predator of the corn earworm moth is the Mexican free-tailed bat. Just outside of Uvalde is Frio Cave. 10 million bats live here. Each night, the bats emerge with one mission: to devour insects. This is the closest cornfield to Frio Cave, which makes it the perfect place to study moths and bats.
We're just beginning this research, and this is a pilot study. So we're just getting things up and running. So the theory of our research is that we can perhaps manipulate the amount of crop damage that's caused by the insects, scare the insects away by simulating artificial bat calls, by playing bat calls out over the crop fields. Maybe a practical insect control strategy for decreasing damage caused by these insects.
In two separate fields of corn, biologists set up two sets of infrared strobe lights, synchronized with a low-light camera and a special device to record the sounds of bats.
We'll be using an ultrasonic receiver, and the output from the ultrasonic receiver will be recorded on the video camera. And then we'll have simultaneous video and acoustic recordings of the bat flight. The video will capture several successive images of the same target, and then each frame will be a continuation of points along that flight trajectory.
Over at the other site, the camera setup is the same, but with the addition of ultrasonic sound.
Right now, we've got on each light pole, we're going to have two speakers faced apart. So we're basically going to have the ultrasound being broadcast in four directions out across this 1 acre plot of corn. And we'll broadcast these ultrasonic signals all night long over this field.
Thank you.
This is an ultrasonic detector, and what you're hearing when I do this, the chirping, that is the artificial ultrasound. The problem with them is these are very monotonous, and real bat calls vary in frequency and in duration and repetition rate. Next month or so, Paul's going to work on getting us a better electronic bat mimic.
Paul Schleider is an electrical engineer who built many of the components of the system and designed the sounds of the broadcast. Bats use echolocation when they hunt for insects. This is their search call. When they locate an insect, the call speeds up as they zero in on their prey. The hearing of the corn earworm moth is also tuned to this frequency, and when they hear a bat, they take evasive action. By the time the team returned a month later, Paul had assimilated both types of calls into the bat broadcast.
We're now capable of basically simulating the call repertoire of the bats, the approach, the feeding buzzes, and what I've got on recording right here is a very, very good facsimile of the calls that bats actually make as they search for, find, and feed on insects. Our hope here is not only to fool the moths into thinking that there's bats out here foraging, but to fool the other bats as well and to bring other bats into the area so that they'll enhance the feeding activity.
Corn earworms also infest cotton. When found here, they're known as cotton bollworm moths. When a field becomes infested, farmers often use pesticides to save their cotton. With field corn, once the plants are growing, no pesticides are used. The amount of crops that the farmers lose depends on the appetite of the corn earworm.
We know we have some damage. It's just how much. Some years it can be worse than others. The numbers can get pretty high at times. I'd say maybe $30 an acre, more or less. This year we'll have close to 400 acres of corn.
That's $12,000 that Ray King won't see when his trucks unload at the scales.
Well, we need all the help we can get.
Help could come with the use of ultrasound.
The results from the experimental plots where we played the ultrasound, insect activity was reduced substantially on some evenings by as much as 70%. The bat behavior was even more dramatic, and we increased the foraging activity of real bats several fold over the treatment plots where we were playing the experimental ultrasound. So in effect, the results of the experiment look really good. We get a double whammy, we reduce the insect activity, and substantially enhance the activity of the bats, which are coming down to forage on insects.
Enhancing pest control with greater efficiency and safety. Better for the environment. Cheaper for farmers and consumers. Could the next weapon in the fight against insect pests be the virtual bat?
Lovely, Gary.
Do it again for me.
It may take some time before this technology can be applied to large fields of crops. But in the meantime, the research goes on.
Are you sure it's on?